So thank you, everybody. I'm grateful that Job invited me to do this non-technical presentation. Because I'm pretty sure that when I'm done, at least one quarter of you will hate me. But I'm not yet sure which one quarter that will be. But do pay attention, but maybe because for the rest of the 75%, the other 75%, this may give you something to think about, or it will at least ruin the enjoyments of your drinks later in the evening. There are a few URLs in the presentation. Let's see if this lasers. It lasers. And if you can only remember the NL NOC 2015, you can find this presentation with URLs you can click on. And it's called Escape from the Data Center, Lessons from a Recovering Manager. The issue, in short, when you work at a technical company, very often your management will think very nasty things about you behind your back. They're not going to say this when they are in the room with you, but they will pretty much be convinced that you're either unreliable, a lying bastard, rude, smelly, or dangerous. If at this point you think, this is untrue, my management loves me and I work at a great place, you can view the rest of the presentation as a confirmation of the wonderful place where you work. So, but behind your back, many things may be going on. So, this is actually the truth. This is the sort of popular management picture. We have this dumb idiot, the pointy-haired guy. He's in charge for some reason. No one knows why. He's stupid. He doesn't get it. And actually, us engineers, and I still consider myself to be a technical person, we are the only smart people in the room. In this comic, the dog is smarter than management. And this is a theory that is widely held. But there is something wrong with the theory. Although, when we try to explain our work to more senior management, they may go like, all these numbers, all these things, can these IPv6 addresses, can we make them shorter because they're too long for people? This is the kind of thinking that's going on. But there is something wrong with the theory that the more senior in management you get, the more stupid you are. And the problem gets worse because we spend a lot of time learning very complicated things as technical people. Whereas our management overlords, they studied art. They had a lot more fun time in school than we did. But still, the picture gets worse. This is how the senior management guy drives around. This is where he probably lives. This is actually nice. This is a villa in Wassenaar. Anyone recognize it?
Yeah.
This is the former headquarters of the Dutch CIA. And they're so embarrassed about it that no one ever wants to talk about it anymore. And no one even wants to rent the place. So it's nice. I tried to get an office there, but it didn't work. So this is how senior management lives and drives around. And these are these art school students we're talking about. Not us that do the complicated things. And this is how they drive. This is how we might drive. And this is how we might live. So there is something wrong with this theory that senior management is really stupid. Because, well, this looks good. This is their evening at home, minus the Shutterstock logo. This is what many highly skilled engineers go through for an evening. So there's obviously something wrong with the theory that management is stupid and we are very smart. Might be true in theory, but in practice it's difficult. So a little bit about me. I claim to be a sort of technical guy, and I still am. So I studied physics. I was one of the first employees of Kazema Internet, which is the forebear of Ziggo. When I arrived, there were 37 customers. I knew this because my modem had the number 37 written on the side. And when I got the modem, it turned out that they had initiated the rollout of the cable internet before they had finished the rollout of the security and other stuff, so I could log in to the main Kazema server and wall messages to the guys that work there. And it was a wonderful time because they said, well, okay, if you know how to do this stuff better, come over. So I got in my bike, got there. I wondered, will I be arrested when I arrived there? But no, they said, sit down, go fix this stuff. So that was the start of my career. And I made many, many mistakes there that I will be talking about later. Then we launched PowerDNS as an open source product. Initially that worked very badly. And I thought, now I need to do something completely different. So I started working for the Dutch government. And I spent 3 wonderful years there and they kicked me out. for reasons which I will explain in this presentation, because I was a fucking smart ass. Afterwards, I joined the management team of Fox IT, where I had a joint venture with them. I was a serious manager at that point. We had 200 people, and that's where I learned a lot of the things I want to tell you about. Then that company got sold. I got frustrated and traumatized by that. So then I went back to Delft University of Technology and did some very interesting DNA research. And lately, we sold PowerDNS to the German company Open Exchange. So the reason I show this whole procession is that I'm a serious geek, really. I wrote an RFC, Peter mentioned that. But I also spent time in management, and I hated that too. So I sort of span the spectrum. This is what you look like when you sell your company to good people. So this is Peter, this is me, we're happy. This is Timo, this is the founder of Dovecot. And this is what it looks like when you're happy when you sell your company.
And the author of Eerzy.
And the author of Eerzy, yeah. So this is a fun guy. And this is what it looks like when you sell your company and it's horrible. See, it looks almost the same. But I learned a lot of things from that. So this is where the presentation breaks down a bit. This is me doing actual code. This is me doing management, sales, and marketing. And I sort of iterate, and I'm getting back to actual code again. And I want to share with you what I learned during these swings, these sort of mood swings. The issue, let's repeat it. Management thinks you're unreliable, a lying bastard, rude, smelly, and dangerous. Jesus. Symptoms. This is where you can recognize, where you can sort of calibrate your own company's experience. What do people really think of me? My management buys million-dollar boxes that I could build as a shell script. So let me give you a prime example of that. Many large telcos in Europe use PowerDNS for their voice over IP call routing. So you enter a phone number, then you need to figure out the right IP address to route that call to. That happens with PowerDNS, and two of the largest communications companies in Europe do that with a Perl script. And that Perl script routes each and every phone call for over 80 million subscribers. It's a wonderful Perl script, written by one guy. And if you buy that Perl script as an appliance, it costs 2 million euros. And we tell our partners, our friends, look, you have this one wonderful guy. He saved you 2 million euros with this Perl script. But he still has to defend it. Because if he doesn't pay attention, all of a sudden people will say, this guy works here. He can't be really good. We buy this appliance. So this is a symptom that you might recognize. You get management coming to you, and they've been influenced by a vendor who sold. He said, this thing, this box we have, it will magically speed up our internet, convert IPv4 to IPv7. And then you have to convince your management and say, no, this is not true. But you find that your manager actually trusts the vendor more than he trusts you. That's a symptom. That's a symptom of he finds you an unreliable, lying bastard. And then you go tell him that he sucks. See? It all fits. Then you think, I'm doing a wonderful job here. My department is doing fine. And suddenly all these guys come in and say, we're pondering outsourcing you to people 10,000 kilometers away that do not speak our language. Wow, if there's one way of telling someone that you don't trust them, is saying, I want to replace you by random people far away. This is not a good sign when you have... And finally, you have the marketing and salespeople. They keep trying to sell products that are not possible. And you find out at the latest moment. There's a great example here of Euronet, a very long time ago. They had a campaign around Valentine's Day. And they printed brochures and things in there. And they said, give your girlfriend or friend a nice gift and a website and whatever. And they printed the whole stuff. And they owned the stuff they printed in bulk. There was a domain name called xxx.nl. This nice sort of Valentine-y thing. Of course, it's full of hardcore porn. But the marketing and salespeople had assumed that, because we're a technical company, we can just put our website on top of the other website. And we'll win because we're an internet provider. And then when it was discovered, these marketing guys found a way to blame the technical people still. It's good stuff. So if you know any of these symptoms, where if you see, look, my management buys this stuff, and why don't they ask me to buy it? And why do I have to tell my own boss, who employs me, who gives me money, why do I have to tell him that my vendor is lying? And if you see any kind of this thing, it might be because of this. So, there are two possible diagnoses to this issue. Is there anyone here, by the way, that now says, Bert, you're full of shit and my life is nothing like that? Be honest.
My life rocks.
You're a manager.
No.
Well, actually, I think the actual for this presentation, the management level doesn't really start just when you have a few people to coordinate, but when you start thinking more about shareholders and less about the people that work with you. So you can still be a manager, and this is not about you. So we have two possible theories why this happened. My management is completely stupid and consists of idiots. That's one hypothesis, and it might be true. If you think that is a tenable situation, if that's a good theory, then remember this. These people are not entirely crazy. The second hypothesis why this is going on is because we as nerds, we as geeks, may have done something wrong, why people have decided not to listen to us. And that's the core of my presentation, to maybe think the other way. Maybe it's not them that are stupid. Maybe it is us. So, some big mistakes we made. We, as nerds, tell us what to do, and we'll do it for you. Please be clear. Give clear requirements. We'll give you wonderful solutions. Don't walk in and tell me a story and sort of expect me to pick up what you want. So, the management layer, they communicate far more indirectly. They will tell you a story, and those apparently were the requirements. Meanwhile, you sit there listening to that story, and you go like this. And this manager, he thinks, fucking hell. And then we go back to this point. And they are extremely good at communicating with stories and facial expressions, because that's when all the nerds leave the room. For managers, this is fantasy land, because then they can just invent new products and everything in the cloud for free. And this is where the phrases come from. Look, if we pressure ripe enough, they will make more IPv4 addresses. This was actually, I think, the CEO of Sprint said this one. So when they have these fantasy meetings, they don't go out to say, we would like to have built this solution. And the other people might say, well, we don't like that. It's very complicated. They look at each other. It's like a movie show, like a romantic thing where people look. Does he look interested in what I just said? He looked interested. Okay, go on. These people communicate on a very different level than we do. So instead of saying, your proposal sucks, they might say, this surely needs more thinking. And then the other side hears, okay, it sucks. Whereas in our world, we just say, no, this sucks and you're ugly. Whereas if you tell a nerd, say, oh, this needs more thinking, we hear, good, he likes it. So this go wrong. So these management people, they read your face, they read your expression, they see, okay, this guy thinks I'm full of shit, but you don't hear what they are telling to you. So this goes wrong. This is a sort of mistake we make. And a typical conversation goes like this. A guy comes in and said, yeah, about the service, I just spoke to someone and they couldn't load a web page. And you're like, yeah, whatever. this is not a problem I can diagnose. And they go back and tell their friends, well, I told our wonderful technical people that there is a problem with the service. But you didn't hear that. And you were right in not hearing it, because this guy just came in and told you a boring story. You should file a ticket. And not how they work. This is the very worst mistake you can ever make. And I have made it frequently. Someone comes in and they have a whole kind of plan, and you're like, oh. And then out comes, you cannot stop yourself. You say, not only shouldn't we do this, you should not be wanting this. And this is like you try to buy a car, and you say, yeah, I like to go skiing with my car. And you say, no, no one should ski. Sorry, don't buy a car here. You're like, this guy is weird. But in the minds of these people, the management, they run the company, and you have to execute what they do. If you ever utter the words, you should not be wanting this, things go wrong on many levels, even though you're right. So this might be someone that says, okay, how about we give two people the same IP address? Would that most of the time go right? And, you know, Well, yeah, as long as they stay far enough apart, then there's a reasonable chance that it will actually work. But you should not be wanting this. Okay. Don't say the words. There's a little more. Remember, these are the people when you say this needs further thought, they hear, okay, this plan is wrong. When you say you should not be wanting this, they hear something about their mother. So I will get later on with some suggested improvements to this. This is our way of really communicating. Falsch! You can imagine how well this goes down with the people that are working on other things than you are. I love this sign. I saw this sign on holiday and I immediately thought of my favorite friends. They can be very clear when they communicate. Another big mistake. You sit there with the nerds, with the guys that actually power the company, and someone comes in with an exceptionally stupid plan, and you take a shortcut. Instead of taking the time and explaining that, okay, this plan could be done, but it has various downsides, and we would feel the pain later on, it would become really expensive. Sometimes we go like, the guy would not understand that whole thing. We'll just say it's impossible. It's nice because sometimes things actually are impossible and like, now we cannot put more pressure on RIPE to make more IPv4 addresses. Sometimes you can just say, no, it cannot be done. It is not possible to do what you want, and managers, they sort of understand that. So sometimes we can whip out that, it's impossible. When we actually mean, no, we don't really want you to do it. But we saw that as impossible. So, but we actually mean we don't feel like it. And all of a sudden, you say, okay, well, it's not possible what you want. And the manager discovers that you were full of shit. And they show up with a vendor and with a carrier-grade NAT device, and which you now have to do a proof of concept for. And this guy remembers, okay, you are a liar. Even though you just took the mental shortcut of not fully explaining to him that, yes, it's possible, but it's extremely difficult. So only use the word impossible when it's actually really, really impossible, like 5-digit IPv4 addresses. So that's nothing like that. So it's not going to happen. This one has killed me at 3 different companies. The project goes wrong, and it gets worse and worse and worse. And each time you tell people, look, you just made it worse with this decision. It's not going to work. And at some point, the engineer's brain, it just explodes. I cannot take it anymore. And you write the huge email, where you explain in long detail why the project is doomed and why it was doomed 6 months ago and that you warned people that it wouldn't be possible. And then you write this huge nasty gram and you press send. And your life in the company does not improve. It is not that people say, oh, finally, the project was going wrong, but now that you said it so clearly, thank you. And you also pointed out how many times you told us already. That's so I'm super grateful now. Now, it doesn't happen. People might say, okay, this looks like a serious email, and this guy is probably right. But fuck, we're going to blame him for it. Because he just documented everyone's mistakes in gory detail. And you have the paper trail to prove that you warned them. You just potentially ruined the careers of 12 people with this huge email. Yeah, I've sent that email a few times. That's why I'm now sort of self-employed. But the thing really is, what did you expect to happen when you write that kind of email? Did you expect people to be grateful when they read it? And yeah, you'd be right, of course, but that's not so. So the biggest tip I can give you, if you ever feel the need to write that email, then first in the to field write my name, then write the whole thing and don't send it. Just keep it printed, show it to a few of your friends, maybe it helps, but do not document your company's failure in this way. Don't send it. Send it to me, send it to someone else, read it to your dog. It's fine, it's not going
to
help.
Feed it to your dog.
Feed it to your dog. At least something happens with it. This is, of course, the original hero of engineering, Scotty from Star Trek. And he was known as the miracle worker, and he could solve the matter beam transporter and the dilithium crystals better than anyone else. But he has a few serious management tips for us as well. Like, if someone asks you for a time estimate, how long will this take? I don't know. And here he explains to us that, well, how long will it really take? An hour? You didn't really tell them how long it would take. It's important, because when you speak about time, this becomes a very important thing for people. So if you ever feel the need to watch some old Star Trek, Scotty has some things to teach us. And the clip is found here. It's pretty good. So time and project management. This hurts so much that I wrote a whole separate blog post rant about it. Someone shows up and they say, look, we're reasonable people. How long will this project take? I don't know. It's something new. Many things might crop up. They say, no, we're all reasonable people. So let's split it up in small things. So how many hours for installing the web server? You say, I don't know, 6. And the database, like, oh, I really don't know. No, just give me some times. Just give me some hours, okay? And all of a sudden, you end up with a 12-month project for deploying one website, because you were like, okay, I need to stick to my promises. So I'm installing the web server, 2 weeks. That should work. And this is a whole separate subject, but whenever I give you one pro tip. Whenever you're faced with that situation that someone sits next to you and says, be reasonable, give me a time estimate. The thing is, either you're doing a very boring project, which can be estimated pretty well. It has been done many times. We know how long it takes to install a web server. In that case, you should be able to give good time estimates. But this is rare. Most of the time, people come up to ask your company to deploy a whole new kind of project that you haven't done before. But still, from you, they want hours. And the big trick in that case is to make sure that any time they ask you how many hours it is, you have more questions in return. So someone says, how long to install the web server? Sure. Have you made up your mind? Should it be Nginx? Should it do IPv6? Do we want denial of service protection stuff? And if you ask enough counter questions, then people will stop bothering you because you are generating more work for them than they are for you. So, but read this blog post. Read. This is my second best read blog post ever, and we've done this as PowerDNS. I promised I wouldn't mention PowerDNS, but I'm still going to do it. We've done this with a number of customers, and it works like magic. So just ask more questions for them. But in short, this is one way in which we alienate management. They don't understand what we do, and the one dimension they can understand what we do is when will it be done. And if we mess that up by either saying it will take 12 months or by being unrealistic, then we get a very bad reputation. So, but also, one thing you should never do if something comes up with a project that you don't feel like, then do not voice the fact, do not tell them that you don't like it by saying it will take 12 months. Just tell them you don't like it. But the URL might be useful. This is another thing. And this is where I personally failed as a manager. As nerds, as engineers, we might be saying, look, we communicate directly. Tell me what you want and I will get it to you. Don't give me hints. Tell me what you want. Turns out that we ourselves do not keep that promise to our management. So this is one of the worst things that happened within teams that I managed, that there were things that everyone in the team knew, except me. And you wonder, how could that happen? So we had one person in the team, and he didn't fit in well. And so finally, after long thinking, we said, okay, we're going to terminate, we're going to fire this guy, or at least not renew the contract. And I thought, I was convinced that the rest of the team would feel bad about that. So I came back upstairs to where the team was, and they could see that I had gone down with 2 people. I came back with 1. So they figured out what happened. And everyone was like, finally. I said, could you have maybe told me that you had problems with this person? No, we assumed that you knew. It turns out that managers, and I'm really speaking from broad experience here, can really just, the things that everyone knows, they might not know. So it is important that if you think, why isn't this guy doing anything about this? Well, maybe because you didn't tell them. This was incredibly frustrating for me. A second point is, we also do not communicate and educate. So you might get your management that suddenly makes a disastrous IPv6 decision. And then you're like, how could they not know this? So I've asked people, so how do you think? Why do you think you didn't share that information with management? They said, well, they wouldn't understand it, and we assume that they already knew. And at most, one of these things is true. we do not spend enough time educating people with what we know, what is obvious for us. Okay, I think we are rounding off the rant. Oh no, we have one more rant, one part. Judging books by covers. We like to say that as nerds that we are not impacted by marketing. Don't give me marketing, give me the hard technical facts. Don't judge a book by their cover. But if you see this URL, it hurts. Just looking at it is like, it's all wrong, there's no HTTPS, it says PHP 3, no. So we've already, based on this technical fact, we've judged everything that hides behind it. Even though it may no longer be PHP 3, it's only PHP 3 because the URL is hard-coded in many places. And this one, sourceforge.com, zip, no. We've made complete judgments based on the cover. Management people do the same thing, except that they don't experience horror when they see this. They experience horror when they see you doing a presentation full of spelling errors, unreadable slides, and you're doing the presentation in a t-shirt with holes in it. Of course, we know that you could be doing the presentation naked and it would still be, the content would be the same. Okay, it would be horrible, but but it's not the clothes that make the man. But you should realize for the rest of the company, they're like, Jesus, this guy, he couldn't even bother to put on the right t-shirt this morning. Where you'll, the people do judge books by their covers. As much as we judge whole banks by their URL, the rest of the company may decide not to listen to you because you're wearing an ugly t-shirt. I am better at telling about this rule than following it, by the way, because this is an ugly presentation. But then again, it's for people that hopefully appreciate the content. So I've shared this story so far, and that's I'm very happy that Job invited me, because I see this gap between how management people and technical people think. This gap is not getting any smaller. When we started the internet in the Netherlands, there were only nerds because no one else understood what we were doing. Right now, as technical people, we are in the minority, and our minority is getting smaller even. And the misunderstanding between management, the senior management, and what these guys are doing over there is getting worse and worse. And also because many people are moving so many of their services overseas and into the cloud and whatever, you can now be a manager maybe of a cable company and just say, is it IPv5 or IPv6 that we're doing this week? I don't know. And people were like, no, it's don't worry, it's IPv8. Okay, good stuff. You don't need to know. And this is getting worse. And not only is the situation getting worse on the management side, it's also getting worse from the engineer side, because we're getting more hardcore in our beliefs. We are more and more convinced that we are right and no one else gets us. It's not that we're accommodating these people, we're more and more convinced that they're idiots. So this cannot end well. So is this all our fault? Because I mentioned a number of things, the email you should never send, the presentation you do in the t-shirt with holes, the falsch move. Is it all our fault? Now, the management people, it's really weird that people at high-tech companies, they hire managers that actually come from an art school. And they shouldn't be doing that. It's wrong, but they still do it. So it's not all our fault. But the problem is, since people are now convinced that anyone can manage a technical company, that situation is not going to change. So we can be angry that senior management doesn't get what we do, but it's not going to change, and we need to do something about it. And it's not that hard to do. For one thing, we can just start trying being a trustworthy partner. So instead of communicating that we don't like a proposal by saying it will take 12 months, maybe we should work on communicating that, okay, this would take 3 months, but here are some reasons why we don't feel like it. These are valid reasons why we don't feel like it. If we realize that no one in management understands what we did, what we do, maybe we should organize a seminar and talk about it. Much as we are sitting here, it is good to educate your company about what happens in the basement. Because that's the other interesting things. We nerds are typically in the basement and in a room with no windows. Apparently, you can get away with that, putting us there, as long as senior management is upstairs and has a nice view. We can be transparent about the reasons why a project is not possible. It's worth investing time in explaining that. Even though it might take a while, it's worth it. And finally, like I said, if you are already convinced that these people will never get it, this will become true. Because if people smell that, okay, I'm not being taken seriously by these nerds here, they will not take you seriously. So if you sort of start on the assumption that some of these management people actually do have a clue, then they might return the favor. So this ends the presentation. Here you can find it with the URLs you can click. These are two relevant blog posts which sort of expand a little bit more on the subject. And I hope this has been useful for you. Thank you.
Thank you, Bert. You know the drill. Now is the time to ask questions. Should you have any?
So either this was extremely clear. Yeah.
Look, that's a manager raising his arm.
He's a CTO even, I hear.
Thanks for your excellent and entertaining talk, Bert. You promised us you would tell us more about the drama surrounding the way you left Rijksoverheid.
Okay, yeah, that was quite actually what happened is so I was literally surrounded by people. Let's go over here. So this is the true story. I found out that many of the people making policy actually were not only in theory students of art, kunstgeschiedenis studenten, they actually were. And I made the mistake of sort of like, I was inspired by Dilbert at the time, as I frequently am. And Dilbert also uses the word art students for managers that shouldn't be managing whatever they're managing. So, and I sort of started using that as an expression where I would sort of tell these people, look, you could not possibly understand this, you were art students. And I had not realized that for them, for many people, it's the problem is what I said was true. You cannot change the truth. If I tell someone, look, I disagree with you, well, we can talk about that and see if we can change that. But once you label someone as, look, you're not possibly ever going to get it, then there are two alternatives. Either they say, yeah, you're right, I wasted my life so far, which is unlikely to happen. And the other alternative is, Bert, the door. And of course, this is the Netherlands, so they're really friendly people. So the way they show you the door is by removing you from all the interesting committees and things. And ignoring you, and I got the hint, but the good news is I left the place, started a new company, and it ended up a lot better with me, and they're still there. But that's good. But that's part of the explanation. And this is also something that I do tell people, if you start working there, you can ruin your reputation as a technical guy quite quickly, just by being too honest. And that's a disease we all share. Like, no, it's wrong! And this guy, okay, that was it. So that's one lesson I have for people is be careful. Just when in doubt, do not speak. And especially also do not email. And especially do not email. Write shorter and shorter email messages and assume that every email message you send gets read out loud during lunch.
What if there's no doubt?
Then maybe you should work somewhere else. No, I'm serious. There are companies that seriously do not deserve us. If a company has decided, look, we don't care about if it's possible or not, we did the brochures already, and the TV campaign starts next week, then maybe you should just leave. Yeah.
But how is then writing that angry email? Not
hold on, Mark. Microphone for remote speakers.
He's in the room. He's not remote.
Yeah. I'm quite close. I can hear myself speak.
Yeah.
Sending the angry email that you know incriminates 12 other people, drags them down in the flaming ball of garbage that the company is, sounds like the I like option on Facebook to me, in my sense.
Okay, well, there is, I think it's a serious point. The serious, should we just sit there and wait as the company goes down in flames? I think that's your question. Now, we do have a role, like I said, to educate people. In a way in which they might, for example, gain your respect. So one thing you could do is, if you see a project that is going down in flames and no one is listening, you might take one pretty senior person and say, look, I'm going to make a private prediction between you and me. I'm telling you this project is going to fail. And if you want to help to prevent that, let me know. But make sure that's a one-to-one conversation. Then the project might actually fail. This is likely. But that person will remember it. Okay, he told me so. But he made it private enough that he didn't shame me for the whole company. And next time round a project starts, you say, yeah, here I am again. And I have another warning for you. And that time you might be taking more seriously. So that is a way in which you can productively help without sending the flame that, yeah, that incriminates 12 people's careers. But it requires a lot of restraint to not do it.
I have a question myself. Earlier you mentioned the Perl script versus the $2 million solution. And in my years in the industry, I've found it challenging to convince some people within organizations, either in my own organization or external ones, how do we get money to the cheaper alternative that maybe is a rough diamond, but at least it's not bringing money to Oracle. And most of us here do not manage our company's wallet. Yet we somehow have to convince this guy that it's a very good idea to click on the PayPal button on the GitHub page, and the manager might be like, GitHub, get out of here. So do you have any hints or advice how to pry money away towards the Perl scripts of this world?
Let me start with two unlucky, bad examples. the Perl scripts I mentioned, and they're completely independent, but they're both Perl scripts, were written under the radar. So no one knew that this is something in that company. No one knew it was something you actually could buy. So they made it and it worked already. And then, of course, the sales vultures come in and try to sell your company that stuff. But they didn't get anywhere because people were like, yeah, we have that already. So this is not a good example because this is actually something that you have to fly under the radar and do secretly. And it happens a lot with DNS. DNS is not something that's on the radar of senior management until it breaks. Regarding convincing people to press the GitHub button or maybe give you some money to spend with which you could do great things.
Yeah, maybe give some money to an Anok Foundation.
I don't have an optimistic answer. I know from one of our biggest users that they've decided that none of their technical people are allowed to visit conferences anymore. So only their managers are allowed to visit technical conferences. Which is funny if you think about it. And these people would become far better engineers if they would be allowed to learn from the rest of the world, but they decided that it wasn't in the cards. So actually the only reasonable thing I can come up with that helps is that you have these people in human resources and they care about employee retention because it's bad for them if people leave too quickly. That's something that they are judged on. So if you maybe manage to frame this as something that, look, we cannot do our work here, it's frustrating to work here, give us a little bit of a budget so we can do our job and then we will continue working here a bit longer, maybe. But I have to ponder this because it's a great question of which I have little experience. Yeah, it won't work. So the question is, why won't it work to just ask for a little bit of money so you can, with a little bit of help, write a nice script?
Hold on.
We have an expert in the room, people. This is one of the people that shares the broad experiences of being a nerd and being involved in very big decisions.
No, being at vendors. One of the reasons that we always use as vendors is that you should not do this internally is, what if Job leaves? You have a support problem. Who are you going to call? If you buy it, you can always call us. We will never go away.
Now, this is true. I mean, we use the same argument as PowerDNS. So,
right, exactly. Exactly.
I have to be honest. So but indeed, it's true. But this goes back to the earlier question. If you are at the kind of company that says, we have more faith in Oracle than we have in our own employees, there's very little you're going to do to change that, except by building up trust over time. But indeed, it's far, because if you are angry at your own employee for not functioning or leaving, you can only be angry at yourself, which is not good. It's far funnier to be angry at Oracle.
But I think, Bert, what you're describing now is actually part of the problem that you mentioned earlier. So if you're in this situation and you tell your manager, we can use this Perl script that we have, or that's very cheap, or for free, or we can spend $2 million, he won't believe you. There's no way he will believe you that those two decisions have the same outcome.
Yeah.
So what you need to do is to present the other option in a way that he understands. So make a business case out of it. Say we need two FTE for supporting this thing internally. It'll cost you this many thousands of dollars, but it's still less than the $2 million. And now you're speaking his language, and he can sign off on a good decision.
Never mentioned free.
No. That's actually, you're fully right. This is part of the educating thing, that you need to share what you do, communicate the value, and indeed make the business case. And making the business case, in turn, means having an understanding of how the company actually makes money, which is something that's good to figure out. Because once you understand how your company actually makes money, many more things start to make sense around you. But this is an excellent suggestion.
Yeah. I want to offer myself as well. I've noticed in the open source donation world, many companies do not budget for this at all. So if halfway through the year I go to somebody and say, I need some money for NLNOC or for this project, you'd be like, sorry dude, I don't have budget. I cannot just mid-year create a few thousands. And if you at your company propose, we need a open source bucket of money, and next year we'll spend 5,000, the year after maybe 10,000. And if the guys sign off on that budget, then in 2016, you will find it very pleasant to just spend that money, because the year before, you already had approval to invest in that type of direction. So my recommendation would be, make this a line item on your budget. If your department has to email a spreadsheet with whatever it is you need, just put a line item there, open source / community building, and go with it.
Very true.
Any more questions or comments for Bert?
Okay, then I have one final remark. I'll be around during drinks, and I would love it if you would come by and tell me if you think this story is just not the reality, or if you think it is your reality, because I need to make sure that I'm telling a calibrated story. So I hope to meet you over drinks.
Thank you so much, Bert.